Good morning, students. Today we are going to continue with the Model 2 syllabus with respect to the other applications. Okay. That is about ELGAML encryption. So we have studied various encryption and decryption algorithm. Okay. With the usage of the various prime integer values, okay, and how they are going to compute the secret key between the two parties. Okay, let us see in ELGAML encryption, okay, how this algorithm is efficient compared to other algorithms. So obviously the ELGAML encryption algorithm will uses a very large prime number P and the generator value G, which is chosen from the set ZP star. Okay, and the private key is an integer value represented as A, where the value of A exists between 1 and P minus 1. The corresponding public key is the triplet P, that is a prime number which is a very large, and G, which is a generator chosen from ZP star, and alpha, where alpha is the encryption key calculated from the formula alpha equals G to the power A mod P. This is the public key values. So at the A, we have the public key with the triplet value P, G and alpha. Therefore, to encrypt a message M, which is lesser than P minus 1, to be sent to A by the sender B, what B is going to do? So if B wants to send a message M, which is lesser than P minus 1, to the A, he will do, initially he chooses a random number R. Again, the value of R is in between 1 and P minus 1. And R is relatively prime to P minus 1. So once the value of R is chosen, B will compute the C1, which equals G to the power R mod P. And also he uses a alpha from A's public key to compute another value C2, which equals M multiplied with alpha to the power R mod P. Once C1 and C2 are computed, he will compute the pair, that is, he is going to send the pair value of C1 and C2 to A. At the A side, to decrypt the value C1 and C2, A uses her private key A and computes C1 to the power minus A multiplied with C2 mod P. Okay. So, how it is possible to recover the original message by A? So, using the formula here, we know that since at the A side, A is going to compute what? C1 to the power minus A multiplied with C2 mod P. Okay. So, that equation, we can equate that to, we have the formula for C1, which is computed at B and it is sent to the A. So again at A, it is going to compute the values. So C1, the value of the C1 is G to the power R mod P and to the power minus A multiplied with, the value of the C2 is M multiplied with A to the power R mod P. That is, this formula is again using the definition of C1 and C2. So when we multiply both of this term, we have g to the power minus a into r multiplied with g to the power a into r into m mod p. Because here, why I am getting one more g here? Because we have alpha. The formula for alpha is g to the power a mod p. So that will be substituted here. In place of alpha, there I will get g to the power a into r, okay, after substitution. Okay, and m as it is, we have written here. So finally, I have this term g to the power minus ar and g to the power ar will get cancelled. I will be remaining with the message m. So the ciphertext computed using this method is twice the size of the original plain text. Okay, because here ciphertext C1 and ciphertext C2 is computed at this side and it is decrypted at the A side. Okay, so let us consider the example. We are choosing the value of the P is equal to 131 and the generator value G equals 2 and the private key at A side is 97. These are the given values. Okay, so now we will compute the alpha value, which is equal to g to the power a mod p, which is equals 2 to the power 97 mod 131, which is congruent to 14. And now the sender wants to send the message m to a. A is the receiver here. Okay, and m is the message to be sent to the receiver A. So we have message m is equal to 75. Now the sender B chooses the random number r equals 33 and he has to compute the two ciphertext C1 and C2. Okay, so C1 is computed using the formula g to the power r mod p. G is 2, r is 33, p is 131. So after computation we will get 103 value. And the ciphertext C2 is message m. M is 75, alpha is 14, r is 33, and p is 131. After substitution, we will get C2 is equal to 51. So C1 and C2 will be sent to the A, which is the receiver. At A side, you will compute the value C1 to the power minus A multiplied with C2 mod P. So we have value of C1 equals 103 minus 97, 103 to the power minus 97 multiplied with 51 mod 131. Okay, so you will be getting 75. That is the message M back. So here A is what? That is, at the A side, he is going to recover the plain text or the original message using her private key value. Okay, A is the private key of A. Small a is the private key of the receiver, capital A. Okay, so using that, the original message is recovered by the receiver A. So the advantage of this EL Gamal algorithm is, by knowing the value of the C1, generator G and the large prime value P, it is computationally infeasible to find the value of R. Okay, that is, the strength of this algorithm is closely related to the difficulty of solving discrete logarithm problem for large values of P. It is where we can have the P in terms of several hundreds digits long. Okay, that's the advantage. But let us see, what are the precautions to be taken? Here we are telling it has a precaution, but it is not the drawback. Okay, the precaution to be taken in EL Gamal algorithm is there is a chance of known plain text attack. Okay, so how this known plain text attack can be performed by the attacker? Okay, so obviously we know that R is a random value which will be unique at each time. Okay, so here that is the random number, the same random number should not be used again. So now if the message M and another message M dash are encrypted using the same random value R, at the sender B side, B is going to compute C1 and C2, and that will be sending to the receiver A. Okay, by using the formula as we know, g to the power r mod p for C1 and m into alpha to the power r mod p for C2. Once it is computed, it will be sent to the receiver A. Okay. So that is with respect to both the messages. For the with respect to the message M, we have the this formula. With respect to M dash, the C1 dash and C2 dash is computed using again this, that is g to the power mod p and m dash into alpha to the power r mod p. For both the messages, C1 and C2 will be calculated. Okay, so now let us assume the eavesdropper is having both the cipher text pair. Now if eavesdropper also happens to have the first message M, okay, suppose he is also having the first message M, then he can obtain the value of the second message M dash very easily. That is because we have the calculations using these formulas. We know that M into C2 dash into C2 inverse mod P equals M into M dash, that is the value of the C2 dash is substituted here. The value of the C2 dash is M dash into A to the power R mod P. And again, the value of the C2 is M into A to the power R mod P inverse. Okay, the value of the C2 dash and C2 is substituted in this equation. M multiplied with C2 dash multiplied with C2 inverse mod P. So when we multiply all these terms, finally we will be remaining with M dash. Okay, so if the eavesdropper is having the cipher text pair and the message M, very easily you can obtain the M dash. Okay, since the same random number value R is used, okay, for both the messages M and M dash. Okay, so we should not make use of the same random number. These are the precautions which is to be taken in EL Gamal algorithm. Okay, so now let us move on to EL Gamal signatures. Let A and the triplet value P, G and alpha be a private and public key of the receiver A, as we know already. Therefore, to sign a message M, the receiver A does the following sequence of procedure. Initially, A will compute the hash of the message H of M. Then she will choose the random number R. Again, the value of the R is lying between 1 and P minus 1. And also R is relatively prime to P minus 1. So once the hash of the message M is computed and the random value R is selected, she computes the value of the X, which is equals जी टू द पावर वाई मॉड पी, वेर वी हैव वाई इक्वल्स एच ऑफ एम माइनस ए इंटू एक्स मल्टीप्लाइड विथ रैंडम वैल्यू आर टू द पावर माइनस वन मॉड पी माइनस वन. ओके, दिस फॉर्मूला. नाउ द सिग्नेचर इज द पेयर कंटेनिंग द वैल्यू ऑफ एक्स एंड द वैल्यू ऑफ वाई. Okay, so the five steps are performed at the receiver A. Okay, so now to verify the signature, the following check is performed because the value have to be cross verified. So the calculation which is done to cross verify is alpha to the power x multiplied with x to the power y mod p, whether it is equal to g to the power h of m mod p. Okay, will be computed and it will be comparing. Okay, so to tell whether it is going to satisfy this equation or not, or this computations whether it is equal or not. Okay, so we according to the equation 4, that's the step 4, according to the step 4 of the procedure of the signature, we have y equals h of m minus a into x into r to the power minus 1 mod p minus 1. So when you take this r to the power minus 1 to the LHS, it will become r into y, okay, and equals h of message m minus a into x plus some constant k value multiplied with p minus 1, where k is the integer. Now on both the sides, raising both the sides to the power of g, and by applying the reducing modulo p, we know the method of reducing modulo p as we discussed in RAC algorithm. Okay, so we will get g to the power ry equals g to the power h of m multiplied with g to the power minus ax. This will get, these two terms will get split. Okay, mod p. And this term g to the power k into p minus 1, okay, this value will become 1 mod p by applying the Fermat's theorem. So we will be remaining with only these terms on the RHS. So now again, by bringing back g to the power minus ax to the LHS, we have g to the power ax into g to the power ry equals g to the power h of m mod p. So alpha to the power x multiplied with x to the power y equals g to the power h of m mod p, right? Because how it became alpha, we know that the formula for alpha is g to the power a mod p, and x equals g to the power r mod p. So in place of g to the power a, we have alpha. In place of g to the power r, we have x. Okay. So this is what the equation, right, to compute at the receiver side for the verification purpose, alpha to the power x multiplied with x to the power y mod p, whether it is equal to g to the power h of m mod p. So we got that. So verification is done here. Okay, so now when we compare this EL Gamal signature with the other algorithms or other signature methods, okay, the EL Gamal signature on a document is not unique. Because why? Here he or she uses a different random number to sign the same document. The different random numbers will be used. Therefore, the signature which will be produced each time will be different. Therefore, E.L. Gamal's signature on a document is not unique. Now, what is the role of an attacker? How he can forge the signature and whether it is possible or not? Let us see. So, one approach to forge a signature would be, that is, an attacker will proceed, okay, will compute, will apply the, an attacker will apply the steps 1, 2, 3 to compute, okay, hash of the message. Then he will choose a random number and he also computes the value of the x, which is equal to g to the power y mod p. Okay, now according to the step 4, he needs to compute the value of y also, which is h of m minus a into x into r to the power minus 1 mod p minus 1. Okay, so that is the step 4 requires the knowledge of the private key A, where private key is the value of the receiver A. So without knowing the value of the A, it is not possible for an attacker to complete the computation of the digital signature. Because in the step 4, the private key value A is needed here. So if the value of A is unknown, okay, the attacker cannot forge the signature because he cannot obtain all the values. Okay, that's the advantage of this E.L. Gamal signature. Now the other related signature schemes are E.L. Gamal signature is comprised of two integers, each of about 1000 bits. Okay, therefore the total space occupied by the E.L. Gamal signature is 2000 bits totally. So how, whether we have any other procedure or the algorithm to reduce this much size? Okay, so we may have one of the method we have is SNOR scheme. Okay, SNOR scheme. So it helps in reducing the size of the signature to less than 400 bits with no loss of security. Okay, so it chooses, this procedure chooses a large prime value P of about 1000 bits so that the following condition holds, that is, the Q is again a prime which is of about 160 bits wide, that divides the value P minus 1. Okay, and the value of the generator G will be the qth root of 1 mod P. So we have the formula G to the power Q equals 1 mod P. And the value of the A chosen is an again integer which lies between 1 and Q minus 1, and A is the private key. So the value of the alpha will be calculated using G to the power A mod P. And also the random number R will be chosen, is lying between 1 and Q minus 1. Okay, so again using this NOR signature, the pair X comma Y is computed, where we have X is equal to hash of M concatenated with G to the power R mod P, and Y equals R plus A into X mod Q. Okay, this is the pair X comma Y using the SNOR signature procedure. So for the verification purpose, okay, it will be checking whether the value of the x is equal to hash of m concatenated with g to the power y multiplied with alpha to the power minus x mod p. Okay, that is the verification is performed by computing the value of x using the signer's public key and checking whether it equals the value of the x. So again, that is that can be done by using these formulas. We know that g to the power y into alpha to the power minus x mod p equals g to the power y into g to the power a to the power minus x. Because we have the formula for alpha equals what? Alpha equals g to the power a mod p. So in place of alpha, g to the power a is substituted here. So when you combine both the terms on the RHS, we have g to the power y minus ax, which equals g to the power r plus k into q, because we know the value of the I, which is y, which is equals r plus ax mod p. So when value of the y is substituted here, y equals r plus ax, and again I have one more term here, minus ax. Plus ax and minus ax will get cancelled. I will be remaining with r. Okay, and plus some constant value k multiplied with q, where k is integer. Okay, and by applying the definition of y, we got the formula here. And finally, we will be remaining with g to the power r, since g is the qth root of 1. Okay. So this is how the verification will be done by using the SNR signature procedure. The signature computed here, the signer computed the value of x and y as a function of the message, a nonce value and a private key. Okay, here we have, as we are seeing here, right? We have the message m value, then a nonce value and a private key. A nonce value is nothing but a random value r. Okay, random value is a nonce value and a private key a. Okay, so the verifier computes the value of the x as a function of corresponding public key. Public key value is alpha, which is equal to the triplet we have again, right? And one of the triplet is alpha, which is equals to g to the power a mod p. So that is nothing but here the public key value. So if the computed value of the x matches the received value, the verifier can be sure that the signer has correctly used the genuine private key, which is corresponding to the public key of the receiver. So this proves the authentication. That is, the signature is authenticated. This is the usage of the another scheme known as SNR scheme, apart from Yale-Gamal algorithm. Okay, which is used to, the advantage of this SNR scheme is to reduce the size of the signature. Okay, compared to Yale-Gamal signature method. So other procedure which can be used are the digital signature algorithm, very famously used in digital signature standard. Okay, and one more thing is a discrete logarithm. Okay, we know we have studied discrete algorithm by choosing okay the value as from a set ZP star or in a prime subgroups of ZP star. Okay, that is, we know that discrete algorithm is infeasible if we have chosen the value from ZP star or prime subgroup of ZP star. So apart from this, the discrete logarithm is also infeasible, okay, if the values are chosen from multiplicative group of or a binary field gf of 2 to the power n. We know that gf stands for Galois fields. Okay, if the values are chosen from gf of 2 to the power n also, this discrete logarithm is infeasible. That is, an attacker cannot guess the values. Okay, so these are the other algorithms which can be used. Okay, so today we have discussed about the EL Kamal encryption method, encryption and decryption method, and as well as the EL Kamal signature and also the other related schemes. Okay, this completes the module 2. Hello.
Yes, students.
Hello, anybody wants to discuss?